One of the interesting things about the aspects on either side of fashioning is when you're preparing your stock, each step serves to mitigate and reduce the previous step. But when you're in the post-fabrication phase and you're finishing, each step amplifies and exaggerates the previous step. So using this lightly planed piece, I'll just show you some of the approaches that you can achieve, certainly with this tool right here, which is based on the French polissoir burnisher. It's a broom straw bundle. Essentially, it's the handle of a broom. And the fellow that makes these for me really did want to know why I was only ordering the broom handles. But as is described in the literature, if you take this on the surface and just rub it, just dry with nothing on it, you actually begin to compress and polish that surface really quite substantially. So in some cases, that alone would serve. I think you can start to see how it's bringing up the sheen. Another step to enhance that even further is to do the polishing and the grain filling at the same time, which would be done by just rubbing the surface with beeswax. And then using the same tool to rub that beeswax down into the grain. Just want to make sure you go over it entirely to get all the beeswax moved around and into the grain. And a lot of people don't realize, I didn't realize it, especially myself, when I first started down this path, how frequently beeswax was used as the grain filler. That was the traditional grain filler. And then just finishing it off with the grain direction here. And then just buffing it off with a little bit of worn fabric. I tend to shop for rags at the thrift store. Worn bed linens or tablecloths are really great. So you can see the effect that you're getting just from that step. And then for the final step, for truly high style furniture, I think was fairly typical of the French to do it that way, and I don't know that other people did or didn't do it that way, would be to spit polish the surface. If you're at all familiar with spit polish boots, you know how that can work. But I'll just fold that up and get it out of the way. But just using a spritzer to spritz your pad, just spritz your soil on the surface, and you just take a little bit of wax, exactly the same motion that you would be familiar with for what we mistakenly call French polishing with shellac. And it actually drags a little bit like that. And so I'm building up a true traditional French polish, which was a wax finish. And you can build it up quite nicely to where you have a luster that's mirror-like. I can't pretend that I'm an expert at this technique because I'm too new to it. I've only been doing this for a few years. But if you get the lighting just right, you can almost see the whisper tales like you get with a spirit varnish. But you can start getting this built up. And this, I believe, would have been the presentation surface for high-style European marquetry. This is what they would have done. Because you see references in the literature that are fairly uncomplimentary about using resin-based spirit varnish polishing as sort of a... A little bit wet there. Let me just work on that a little bit more. I'm not sure if you can see it where you are, but I can see that the gloss is building up. I won't pretend that this is an easy or effortless finish. This isn't the same as vomiting some polyurethane on the surface. This is a very different approach. Starting to take shape here. A few more hours of this piece would be just about perfect. But given the time constraints we have now, I think you can just begin to see the effect that is building up. For a second, and have any last water flashing off, and then again just using a piece of warm cloth, you can just lightly buff it. That's the kind of surface you can begin to get. That's all the magic right there. Okay. One of the distinctions between hardwoods is that you build up an even sheen, or softwoods with a high density difference, is that it actually begins to wallow out, you know, like a well-worn pine floor has that glorious feel. This tool does the same thing, but in seconds. While it's cutting the fur off, it's pounding it down. So, here, let's burnish down a little bit. Heat the iron up, and they would have used soldering irons for this.
Okay.
So what they would have done is introduced this by putting the wax up against the iron and just melting it in.
All right.
And then they would have spread it around with that iron, and there are soldering irons that look literally just like this in their configuration. Just melt it in. I'm getting some on your workbench, I hope that's not a problem. And you just get that surface really sopping wet with molten wax. And this is actually probably the best thing to do with butcher block counters in the kitchen too. just melt beeswax into them. It's pretty hard to go wrong with that. And then we're gonna let that just cool itself off. And then you take a boxwood scraper or any real high wood, high density scraper. I have one that I made out of kingwood, which is one of the rosewood family. I couldn't put my hands on it early this morning, so. But Rubo talks a lot about these, they call them polishing sticks. And you would have a whole number of polishing sticks for whatever surface you were working on, rounded, flat, convex, concave, mm-hmm. doesn't really matter. But then as soon as this got really cool, and by that I mean mm-hmm. room temperature, this gets to be hard enough that you can scrape the surplus off and leave essentially a burnished surface just with this. And then on top of that, you can put some water polishing, spit polishing on top of that, and the surface just pops. But again, the key is that the wax is the grain filler. Who knew that wax was the grain filler in the old days? I mean, but it was in the old trade recipe books. We just weren't paying attention. So you just go along here and scrape off the surplus. And however, the edge of the tool will determine what the texture is. So if you have a nice crisp edge to the surface, it will leave quite a wondrous texture, a smooth, polished texture. Let me just see what that looks like. Yeah, you can begin to see how that looks, just with nothing else, except beeswax that's cleaned off. And then you could just buff it a little bit, which is also quite a pleasing surface. Again, a perfectly serviceable presentation aesthetically. And then if that's not enough, then you can go back to your spit polishing rag and spritz it, and you just want the tiniest little bit of wax, not mm-hmm. much. It's not like you're waxing furniture. You're just spit polishing furniture. So very little wax and just enough water to make the whole thing damp. And you. You can have a piece of wood good enough to wear to the parade grounds for inspection. But one of the things that I found is that there's a great book years ago, the title of the book was much better than the book itself, but it was called The Past is a Foreign Country. And we tend to look upon historic craft techniques as this some sort of, these old guys in linen shorts communing with the wood. Well, they weren't communing with the wood. They were producing stuff because they had to do that in order to eat. And so they found the fastest, easiest way they could get from point A to point B. They had to get from bark to varnish as quickly as possible. So they weren't communing with much of anything. This also works really well for in the wintertime when your lips are cracking. Just swipe your lips real fast and moisten the pad and balm your lips. And also you have to have a much lighter touch with this than shellac pad polishing. With shellac pad polishing, you really have to bear down on it. With this, you're lifting up the whole time so that your contact pressure is less and less and less and less as you go along. At least that's been my experience. So again, we'll just let that flash off for a minute. And then buff it up. You're obviously not going to get the same sheen because the wood is softer. But the soft glow from this, even on a large piece of pine, is just lovely. Just lovely. So that's about all the different approaches for this type of wax finishing that I know how to do. So there's the key number one. There's the key number two.